the first half, they're starting maybe 2 minutes late. So Shakil has spoken here before, so thank you for, you know, coming back. I think we hosted him well last time. He came back, right? And he also brought a friend along, Nandan. Shakil works at Cisco and Nandan works at Microsoft. So this is the first time we are doing a talk with two people, so I'm really excited to see how it goes. So welcome, Shakil, to the stage. During the talk, if you think you can't hear them, just raise your hand so they can get you mic. Their first preference is just to shout, otherwise we lose mic. We will switch off one of the ACs so we can raise some mics.
Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
I will introduce myself after the talk. We can start.
You were introduced before as well. So let's start what Anand said before. I should start with some of the sharing.
So we are so much in with the sharing.
In with the sharing.
Everyone can hear, right?
Start
with
but
normally
technical.
Let's start with the microphone.
Okay, so I have been here before for Samantha Architect Meetup. And I presented on scalable architecture using AWS. Today I have
Nandan. Excuse me. It would be nice if you can be in the microphone.
Let me try once more. Today I will be discussing about big data architectures with Nandan. Nandan will be describing more on what you can put in the Microsoft offering in big data space and how you can utilize Microsoft architecture, design patterns, as well as other use cases studies having. And I will be explaining a little bit on architecture on big data and a building perspective, where I will be pointing more to Hadoop and Hadoop. So this is a little bit about myself. I am authoring a book on big data space for AWS, that is in Apache's Phoenix. And apart from that, I am a certified architect. And also, I contribute for Apache open source projects. Is it better now? Yes, sir. Okay, thank you. I think we have too much space. If you want, you can come here.
Maybe you can try mic. Is it okay?
Mic. If it's not it. You are not able to hear me, please let me know, then I can use your mic.
We are able to hear you, but sometimes when you turn around, then it's some words we lose.
Mic is better.
That's the problem.
Sit down.
And I just want to introduce Nandan here. This is about Nandan. He is representing the team in Microsoft Azure. And Nandan.
Yes, yeah. So I have been working with Microsoft for more than 4 years now. And I have been into multiple teams here, including Azure, Bing Ads. A couple of solutions that I have designed in Azure is the Store Simple team. So Store Simple is a hybrid storage by, which is an acquisition by Microsoft, which provides an enterprise scale storage solution, which is where your core data sits in cloud and your pod data stays in on premise. And I have done Azure certification. Prior to Microsoft, I was working with Sun Microsystems, where I was developing and designing a solution for Azure cluster and server certification. So that's pretty much what I'm
So, how many of you are already using big data? And I am talking about Hadoop or Splunk, your many other big data space technology. How many of you are already using it? Very few people, right? So other people, I think they have an inspiration to use this in their upcoming projects or something. I hope so.
Hello.
In this session, what we are going to explain, this is the agenda. Big data, little bit on the big data term. I'm not going to explain the detailed things. I will be just giving the abstraction and little bit on how you can utilize some patterns, what kind of patterns you can apply to thinking about some different layers in big data, how you can utilize them building a scalable architecture, utilizing big data space technologies as well. Okay. And what technologies could you use for big data? There are a bunch of big data. Even if you talk about a storage solution of big data, more than 200 plus big data storage solutions are there, right? And same thing, is there any alternative to Hadoop, or you should be sticking to the Hadoop view, right? Architecture pattern, this is an important
component when you
start looking for the architecting of big data. So my focus will be here mobile on, because when we divide our big data layers, we focus on the patterns, and the patterns is basically focus on the LITs of big data architecture.
Right, when I say LITs, it
might be your scalability, maintainability, availability, those things, right? Then we'll be looking on Microsoft big data solutions, when we will be describing how Microsoft is coming up the big data solutions. When you might be like aware of Hadoop solutions and
how you can apply Hadoop, Hortonworks,
Cloudera, and many other distributions that we have, MapR as well. But he will be telling how Microsoft revamped itself that you can run them in the Linux or Unix environment, and what kind of cases for these and solutions you can use.
Is there any problem?
You should have closer.
Closer.
Yeah, so I would like to add to Shakir over here that what was the alternatives to Hadoop? The first question that Shakir asked. Yes. So LT Insight, which is by Microsoft, okay, that is a solution, that's an alternate solution because of that we have been using as a big data platform.
Okay, so let's, everybody knows here what the big data is. So if you talk about the ever-increasing big data space, in big data space, what we basically discuss more over volume, the volume of the data is too huge that we are not able to suppose provide a reasonable
solution that can implement our SLAs. This is, I think, better than this.
You want to do this?
Okay, so the volume, when you talk about the volume, it could be your volume coming from digital enterprise, coming from IoT devices, or coming from any other digital interaction, human generated data, or machine generated data. Velocity, how fast the data is coming, it is like real time streaming, or it could be your batch analysis that you do utilizing Hadoop or some other processing behind. And variety of data, how you can classify your big data problems, right? You have to like look the different types of data is coming, structured, unstructured, or whatever my type of data you want to look for. So these things, how the big data increases there, if you look into the Gartner space, they are saying in 2026 the space of big data technology will go 90 billion. So this is the prediction that our IT is going on. So I think we should be focusing on how we can provide these same solution to our customers so that we can win in that space, right? So, is there any reference architecture for big data? Anybody here who knows the reference architecture for big data? By the way, there is nothing in reference architecture, just like any other space of architecture. But here, you can say something. I will tell you like the components that you can plug together that might be looked as an architecture for big data. What tools should be used? I think many of you might be aware or heard about the tools in the big data space. There are a bunch, and there are tools that you can apply. There as a cloud service provided by AWS or Microsoft Azure, or provided by many other like vendors in the cloud space as well, right? So I'm just touching upon some of the architecture principles that you should look when you are building a scalable big data architecture solution. So decouple our data bus. I don't have that, I will not be going, as I told you, in the deeper level of something, because I will not be able to cover if I will go deeper level. If you have any other question that goes to the very minimal and micro level, you can ask me offline. Okay, the decoupled data bus, what generally we do in big data, we have a data, first let's find out from where we can take the input from the data, then store it somewhere, process it, and provide the answer to the business that what is the insight I am looking for. Right? Then use the right tool for the job, the right human I am talking about, it could be your data structure that you are building. The data structure, you might create your custom data structure, or you might be using some of the libraries already available for you. As in the data science, Nandan is also working on data science, right? You are using some of the APIs for this, right?
Yeah, definitely. I mean, a couple of APIs that are actually being quite open. There are a lot of open source tools, as well as there are the cloud solution which are providing machine learning as a service already. Microsoft Azure is providing machine learning as a solution. Similarly, Google has come up, more than a couple of months back, they opened up their platform to use machine learning as a service. So all the algorithms and all that you need to use on a day-to-day basis can be provided as a service instead of you having your own libraries all together or using a third-party library. It's available in the cloud itself. And you can also leverage the power of the cloud, as in your entire data itself is there in the cloud. On top of that, you have machine learning also as a service, so the entire work can be done on top of that.
Okay. Then the data structure, so many of the somebody is data scientist here, they might be using predefined algorithms. Most of the time they are going to be using 4 to 5 algorithms, okay? The latency is very much important when you build an architecture there. Why? Because anyway, we cannot compromise with our SLAs. Our customer do not compromise. There might be a little bit flexibility that rather than going 5001, you can go 5001. But there will not be a very high landscape where you can look the latency can go down and you are building a very high scalable solution. That's not acceptable by any of the customers in big data solutions. Okay, throughput and access pattern. So the access pattern I will be explaining here when I will be going deeper into the architecture modular fashion and how, what kind of access pattern and other layers, what patterns which you can apply there. Many of you might be knowing the combination of architectures, Lambda architectures, you can utilize that and you can think of the speed of servicing layer and how you can divide your dash layer, your incoming streaming data, that you can do there, right? So that Lambda architecture, Kafka architecture also you can use for the big data space. So how you can utilize, these are the architecture principles that you can plug it into your big data solution and then it will help you to scale your architecture. Considering all the three things of the big data, volume, velocity, and variety of the data, right? Leverage cloud managed services. When you are building a big data solution, you should be leveraging the cloud managed services. In cloud managed services, I am saying more over like, think about something, Amazon started one of the services called Lambda, right? The Lambda services, like it can automate the whole infrastructure rather than any human intervention there. So you can build an architecture, a very huge solution, very huge architecture without even touching it. So something like that. So try to like automate your architecture, how much you can do. It might be like you are creating a VM on the fly and that VM will be created using some script or it will be created using some emails that will come into the Lambda or something else. And low admin intervention, try to keep minimum admin intervention. If that admin intervention is high, think about if you are building a Hadoop cluster of 1,000 nodes. It's very much complex as well as very much tedious for a person who is looking that big system. Right? So it's like suggested that you can try to automate. I know that it's not like only automation is possible, but you can think of as minimum as admin intervention in that.
So is it something like a workflow-based system?
Yes, you can build as a workflow system and this is also like an eventing kind of thing. So let's say I have 40 nodes of my cluster, but I want to add 2 more nodes. That the requirement is there because I was not expecting the data is coming from some geospatial node, right? So as soon as that event will be ingested into my system, automatically I will be getting 2 more instances of my cluster. So 2 more cluster will be there. So the big data should not be a big cost. If there is a big cost, what will the impact? You will not be able to save the solution outside. There are companies who can bid something and they can say, I am selling the solution as very, very cheaper. The download cost goes down, your leadership team is very happy, you will see your CQS, CI, look at this is the guy I was thinking, right? So think about that thing. So always try to minimize your cost. That's why like Hadoop, they are certifying Hadoop on commodity hardware. They are not certifying on specified hardware. That cost is not growing that much. So So this is simplifying the big data processing. So when you design and big data solution, so this is basically the pillar of things that you should be looking in your application. Okay. The pillar thing here, ingestion, how you can do the ingestion of data. When I say ingestion of data, think about like when everybody is coming to this meter, they might be coming from one gate, right? So the ingestion, you can apply a little bit pattern on that one. How fast and frequent, as well as efficient way you can ingest data into where you are doing the processing for that, or what you want to do with that data. Right? That is important. Then store. So when I say the store, you ingested the data. Obviously, there should be something, either file system or it could be a database where you will be storing this data to do some processing on it. Might be your NoSQL databases, it might be your some other cloud offering, or just like Amazon S3, something is,
In Azure site is Azure Blob Storage. Azure Tables for the NoSQL.
So how costly is Microsoft? They are very costly, right?
How many of you have used Microsoft Azure or any of the providing suppliers? How do you find it?
Not necessarily that expensive.
Yeah,
I'm
okay.
He will never say that expensive because he's not there.
I get for free. So.
Like it's expensive for Microsoft.
Okay,
it doesn't happen every.
That's true.
Definitely some use case.
Yeah, that's like an architect to win. He buy use case script this one. Why should I use this one?
That's true.
Right.
Cost is a function of market.
Yes.
Yes.
Then we have to process or analyze the data, put our algorithms and the implementation of the data. It might be running some MR jobs, or it might be like you are running some machine learning algorithm to do some of the data processing. And finally, you will be consuming or initializing some of the visualization tools that will be presenting how your data is presented to the customer. Right? That comes to your KPI implementation, where you basically create the dashboard and so on. Splunk kind of thing. Anybody knows about Splunk? So we do that. You can see how the data is working. Okay. Yes.
So how does this change for streaming the data when, let's say, you have surveillance devices, IoT devices, right? So you have pumping data and you need to do some sort of decision in real time. So this process, does it change for streaming the data?
So this process is not going to be changed for anything. So these are the like pillar components for big data. When you talk about the streaming pattern, the streaming will come here. Because here you can have data that is coming continuously at a real time, or you can have data that is coming from some of the data warehouse. It might be coming data from many of the systems, your RDBMs or something.
So probably you will fork from there and make some decision there, and then you probably will not get to the store. Maybe you wait to the store for some time and then take decision right there.
I will talk about your scheming data. Like you might be utilizing the, just say I am saying the click scheme data I want. Coming on the real time. After that, I want to do the processing. You might be using some Kafka implementation. And the Kafka is either, it's not like we don't want to keep a very long time of the system stored there, but it's supposed to be stored for in memory.
Sure.
So now this was previous slide was on how you can categorize your architecture. We have four plus components that we should look for big data categorization. And now we are looking how we can define the layers of the digital architecture. So when I talk about the layers here, the infrastructure and service layer, is this appropriate here or like I just brought up something else? I think all of you might be knowing this one, right? IaaS. So IaaS from Microsoft
Azure
Machines, yeah. Microsoft is providing Azure virtual machines there. So infrastructure as a service, why it is important? Finally, you have to store data somewhere. And when we talk about the storage, you might be looking for storage either in the cloud, or you might be looking creating your own data center where you can store it. And platform as a service, PaaS, you can build data as a service that can be exposed to the user and they can use that. And I think nowadays the people are starting creating these kind of services for their business. Right?
You don't have to manage your own hardware altogether, right? Say any new update comes in. If you're having your own SQL Server installed, right? I mean, in that case, you have to upgrade your servers. Instead, if you're using SQL Server as a platform as a service, right? I mean, all the management is taking care of it. And you have to focus only on business.
So a PaaS system basically like here same thing. I am not bothering about how my data should be analyzed and something would be happening. If I am a vendor, I would be providing you a dashboard where you can see that data analysis is going like this and my graph for this year is like this. That is like what the customer will do, right? So that's why like the platform as a service is also like popular nowadays. Then data as a service, this is also like popular nowadays, the big data business function as a service. So you can focus on particular functionality of a business and then you can expose the rest of your data. Sometimes what happens, people try to build these solutions for their own organization. And they see that I can get the benefit out of this. And they can scale this to the outside. That kind of thing you can find out here in the business information. So these are the layers, the dividing architecture into layers. Now think about, I have an application architecture for my big data. Now I am dividing into layers. Why we are dividing into layers? Think about the layman, web application architecture that you create for J2EE or your Microsoft IES something, right? So why we are trying to divide into layers?
Segregation of
concern. So there are a principal architecture called separation of concern. So we are mostly focusing on that principle, like separation of concern. And apart from that, we look for how we can scale our component without like providing high cohesiveness or coupling. So it should be loose coupled or those. That's why we divide into architecture into layers. As you say, okay. So anything like something different from Microsoft?
No, it's a generic principle, right? I mean, it's just all the providers have an implementation of that.
I think I'm better with this. Okay, so first we have ingestion layer, then storage, security. Security as such is not a layer layer, but each and every layer, you have to look how you can build the security layer. And so this comes in your NFR, okay? Non-functional requirement for any architecture. Same thing is here in the big data solution. And the monitoring, these two things I put here, you should be focusing on these two terms. But they might not be graded, oh, I have security layer only, and this component will be working as security driver only. No, it's not like that. You have to look security each and every layer that's required. Then we have like analytic engine, search engine, and the visualization layer, right? I will be going a little bit on what kind of pattern of things you can use there. So this is architecture component. Think about some big data architecture component, how it looks like in these layer terms. So we have monitoring layer. We have security layer, right? On top of that, what we are trying to do, I am putting some of the technology stack that we generally use in our big data solution for application, right? So we are using Hadoop here, then Hadoop storage layer. That Hadoop storage, where we say it could be your LTFS, right? Or HFS if you are looking for NoSQL solution on it. Or here, Hadoop platform management layer. You might be using OOSI, any of the like UI that comes into your Hadoop ecosystem, you can utilize here, or you can build your own API. Okay. Then visualization layer, your administration, then data analysis, ID index, and visualization tools. There are many visualization tools like Tableau and many more tools you can find out from the visualization space like this. Here, this is your ingestion layer. Ingestion layer can get the data from the sensors, it can get the data from a video stream, or it can get the data as your click stream logs. Many things could be there. So we will see how these layers and architecture can fit together and we can build a scalable solution on big data space. Okay. This is a simple example where I am trying to depict how you can build an architecture for a simple application on big data space. So this is an example for big data application. What we are going to do, we have a log ingestion here. The log ingestion will be going in the application. Then I have a learning application where I am putting my machine learning algorithms and then I am trying to do some such analysis. Hey, I am looking this kind of string in my data store. Is this available or not? Then I will bring this plan to the user that is required for me. So this is a simple example of how the big data is using data. Okay. So these layers, what are the components in these layers? I cannot like, I don't have like slides do it too much, that's why like I am just cutting short and putting into one slide all these layers. So in ingestion layer, what we are trying to do mostly, the components if you think about, the identification, the integration of data. First we need to identify what kind of data is this. Is this structured, unstructured, whatever, the combination of those two. or something else. You need to see that. And then the filtration is there. You need to filter the data, define the data classification algorithms, or try to find out the data and put into the right place that you want to ingest there. Then the validation, if you are looking for validation, provide the validation there. So most of the time we need to like avoid the validation there, right? Then the noise detection. The noise detection obviously is important. You should be like focusing on what type of the data is important for your analysis, not the complete data. So try to reduce the data that is not important for the system to ingest. Then transform the data, compress the data, and send for the processing from the data. Okay? When you go to the storage layer, so what kind of thing you do on the storage layer? Storage, we are trying to store something, right? Think about it, 10 years what you do. You have many databases there, you store there, you might have some caching technologies where you will be using it. You might have the ingrid mem, where you can keep the complete data there. All these things you can do here in Big Data Space as well. But there are some classifications of these NoSQL data storage as well as other storage, so we can take it from there. So these are like some of the technologies that you can utilize in your storage layer to build your storage layer for your application. It could be React, it could be MongoDB, or CloudFinish, or going to the like email pair, your Atbase could be there, Google Bigtable could be there, Dynamo. Many more are there, so you can find out what is like important and what kind of problem you are looking and the solution that you are looking for. Each and every database is solving a specific problem, right? It's not like all NoSQL databases perfect enough and they can solve each and every problem. No, not like that. Third is your monitoring layer. In the monitoring layer, this is important because you have a very huge cluster of machines for big data applications. So you need to like monitor your application to see how the health of your application is there. And if there is a problem in your system, how you can rectify it. So this is the first like point from here that you can get the notification, how you can modify the things so that your system will be behaving normally. So the monitoring layer, you can utilize tools like Angular or Azure. These two tools are very much popular in that space that you can utilize here. Is there anything from Microsoft for this?
So see, a couple of services we have provided in the Azure marketplace, which is New Relic, which is a monitoring for your application altogether. Right? But apart from that, the dashboard itself gives that good information about how your machines are performing. Say, your disk storage is reaching above 80%. So one alert or one kind of monitoring page should be there that should alert the administrator that hey, some limit has been reached, right? So you have to act accordingly.
Monitoring is which level? It is in the app level or service level? You mentioned it is storage in the data.
It can be at any level, in fact, right? I mean, let's say the new relic that I talked about, it integrates into your application, right? And your application can be monitored from there. Say, how many queries are, oh, 1 second, I'll come back to it. So how many say queries are coming to your system altogether per second or something? So that's at the application level. But at the architecture level, architecture say you have thousands of nodes. So some node has gone down. So you have to have some administration page on your cloud service provider or your big data provider where you can monitor that what exactly is going wrong in my system.
I would request you guys like you can ask the question offline because there are many things inside. So you will not be able to cover up there.
Just one question.
Yes.
Yeah. You mentioned that there are tools for the storage layer for monitoring. What about the ingestion layer? Any kind of
you can do monitoring each and every layer. Okay. Yeah. I can tell you one example there. Have you tried Amazon CloudTrail? CloudTrail is one of the API that can give you the insight what is happening whenever you are doing the coding or running any of the key component there. So same thing. Let's say the data ingestion data is coming to you. Okay. You want to monitor the data. How you build your batch system, right? You see this data is not important, you might provide some 3 to 4 skips, 5 skips, after then you can say, hey, go to this some other queue or go to some other.
My question is, what kind of system you want?
Are there any ready-made tools?
Yeah.
Like you
supposed
to do for storage
or
ready-made tools for ingestion layer?
Right now, I don't know any like such tools, like very much, first of all, like there are some tools, but not that much efficient, okay? And one more thing, like why you are looking for the tool here? This is my raw data. Why are you looking for the tool? Why you want to do the like this kind of inspection here for the data?
It's a bus, right? So there could be, they can be to, multiple threads or even multiple nodes.
Yes, you do multiple threading, you do multiple streaming, and many things.
There is a question. Is there any?
So normally, what we do is we have a generation
store, right? But I can tell you, like, if you are putting too much validation for the raw data there, you are restricting your architecture there, first of all. Okay. So that should not be bottleneck. The data is coming to us, I don't care about what kind of data is coming. I am putting the right storage there, and after that I am putting my processing there. That is important for me. The data can come from anywhere. You can use CouchDB, you can use MongoDB.
And so where does the SDFS come into
the picture? SDFS comes for the processing of the batch process. So I will be switching to the architecture. Other types you might be able to. We will like give you
all these answers. I will
be giving you like question answers this and time. We didn't like reach to the half of the slide. Okay. So if you want to ask
question, I can
set up the PPT, then you can answer the question. I don't have an issue on that. Okay, so security layer considerations, I want to skip this and come back like later, then we will try to. This is important because we are focusing on the pattern. The pattern is important that I already discussed about that.
Okay, so the pattern then
we discussed about the ingestion pattern.
What kind of pattern you can think about?
The pattern here, somebody was saying like if I have multiple threads running for that one. Yes, you can have multiple threads, but threads. That kind of thing is very much like usable for multi-threading programming when you are trying to do, but when you talk about a big data space, you are talking about the streams of the data. Another thing of the data. That is, you can think of something that analyzes you are doing for the data. Okay. So here we have a pattern called multi-source architecture pattern. This will fit Fargo, that kind of requirement. Okay. Then we have protocol converter pattern. The protocol converter should be like, see in this way, like I have a different protocol, but my system do not understand that protocol. I might apply these logics to can take the data into my system so that I can do my processing. Multi-destination pattern, one of the data center is there in US, one of the data center is Mumbai. So I want to pull up the data from there. There are patterns that we can require it. At the same time, the real-time streaming pattern is quite much popular. I'd be using your Apache Spark or like this.
Most of you have IoT devices,
Spark? Yes, exactly. So somebody was saying that IoT device, right? You guys are able to join me after without this. This is really scary for me. Okay, so these are the patterns. Okay, I'm not going in the detail of the pattern. I'm just throwing a point in front of you guys so you can look.
Like
that
as well?
If I have the time, I can explain more here. So the multi-source pattern you can see, like I have many sources of the data. It might be your emails, it might be your unstructured data, it might be your tags, it might be your clicks that you guys are looking for. All these data you can pull it and put it into some of the enrichment pattern, right? Enrichment pattern if you might like utilize enterprise integration pattern, we have enrichment pattern. Same kind of thing we are building it, but only the difference is here we are building a large scale, not that scale what we're looking for. Okay, then we have protocol converter pattern, same thing. I have a byte stream, I have files that I want to do, but I am going to store my SDFS. So there is a limitation how we need to store this data for my processing. So we have to do the converter on. Multi-destination, as I told you, so you can see this kind of graph. We already have the enrichment there. To require the enrichment, you can put the enrichment. If your system can understand all these streams, you can directly ingest it. There is no like requirement, hard and fast requirement for enrichment here. Then see this diagram. This diagram we discuss about the layers. So here we are trying to build like an ingestion layer. In the ingestion layer we have all these patterns applied. Where these patterns will be used? Okay. So here protocol converter pattern will be useful when we have data sources coming in. And then just in time transformation here. Real time you want to do the transformation of your data, you can do there at that time. Okay. Then the real time streaming also you can do. You might be like doing analysis for the video, who is watching the video in the world for this particular movie or something. Okay, then the storage pattern. In the storage pattern, we have Passat, we have Ring pattern, NoSQL pattern. Most of the time, we encounter this NoSQL databases. People are very much traditional RDBMS system, it's not about doing that. So you can be polyglot pattern. So this is important pattern for us, as you said. Like the polyglot pattern, what we see, In traditional enterprise, we don't have like all the system are DBMS.
We don't have a system, all the systems are mostly components, right? It might be your some storage from a data warehouse, some storage from RDBMS. Okay, all these things you can do there. So this is the how the polyglot pattern looks, the storage layer associated pattern. So this is like NoSQL pattern can come here, okay? The deal pattern can go there at that time. The data access pattern. We can apply this data access pattern, the state transformation pattern and converter pattern, the service locator pattern, the near real time pattern, where like we want to do some sort of like data access analysis on the real time. You can look on that street and do the analysis at that time. So then you can like Nishant was saying, like not store the data. From there itself you can provide the analysis what you're looking for. Same thing you can do from the near time. And okay, so okay, that's it. How the cryptographic representation of this pattern that you can use it. This slide will be shared with you guys. So like if you want to go detail pattern, you will be you can take it out from there.
Hello, person.
The access layer pattern,
here it will be ETL, data visualization, report,
HTTP.
The extension kind of architecture where you have cache systems here. You have
NPFS where you are putting the data in,
and after that you are providing UI where you can watch out what is happening with your data,
right? It could be your
reports, it could be your
information, it could be your stuff like Splunk, manually you can do from there. Data discovery and analysis pattern.
So here we are mostly focusing on the discovery and analysis. There most of the time we are trying to focus on machine learning pattern. Machine learning pattern, basically we apply certain algorithms and try to analyze what the data is saying to us, and after then getting the insight of that data we can represent the index based insight is the same thing. The index on the data should have been faster access for me, and if you want to do the index basis, okay, same thing you can do this. So this is how nice the pattern is in this space, the data cubic pattern. The cubic pattern is like data is coming in, and after that I want to take something from I can do that. So how the data is ingested into the SGFS, that
should be coming in for different kind of sources and we can process it.
Okay, master view pattern, and these are like visualization pattern. Like now we have covered on like storage as well as there. Now the visualization pattern, what we do, we create the UI. And the UI, how you want to show to the user, it might be as a portal where you want to show to the portal itself, right? The portal could be your legacy enterprise portal. You might be showing something on the zone pattern. These are the zones, like some of the US zones, some of the India zones, something I can do that one. In the master view pattern, like many of the application is shown on the one page there. This kind of pattern can apply. So this is how the cryptographic representation looks like. Okay, the zoning is here. You can define the zones here. So if you look upon AWS, they also have this kind of pattern for their own services there. The deployment pattern, now you are going to deploy your solution there, what you are trying to do. At that time, you are focusing on how many nodes, what they are like to keep my machine here. You want to be focusing on the security here as well, right? The DNA cost pattern, where you want to automate many of the things you can put there. The case studies are here. There are two case studies. I will pick up this case study later. That's Nandan should start from his Microsoft one. He has Patel.
Okay. So, thank you, Shubhi. I will only touch base upon the big data solutions which are being provided by Microsoft and SD Insight in a little bit of detail. So how many of you have actually worked on SD Insight ever? You have tried. Okay. So all the solutions, all the big data solutions that Microsoft is providing right now is built along with Hortonworks, right? Hortonworks is a company which is giving a distribution of Hadoop altogether. So all the solutions which are provided right now with Microsoft and Hortonworks working together in order to boost the big data platform. This is completely 100% compatible with Apache Hadoop, and whatever work is being done as part of this project is also being sent to the community back, so that there are no compatibility issues. And whatever Hadoop distribution is there in the market right now, Microsoft Azure makes sure that the same distribution also comes back to the SDN side. Well, so these are the three different solutions which are being provided by Microsoft and Hortonworks working together, which are based on FTP, that Hortonworks data platform, right? You had a question? No. Yeah, so first one is LTInsight. So LTInsight is nothing but it's a distribution of Hadoop on Microsoft Azure. And it uses the compute and the storage which are built within Azure in order to power the LTInsight, which are, say, it uses the Azure cluster to run LTP. And integrate for the storage, it is using the Azure storage, which is nothing but the block storage. Hortonworks data platform for Windows. So this is kind of a standalone solution. Say you want to create your own Hadoop clusters on Windows devices. It could be a physical device or it could be a virtual machine altogether. The third one is quite proprietary to Microsoft, and even I don't have much of work experience, but on this one, I mean, this is a combination of the MVP engine, which is combined with the that Microsoft parallel data warehouse platform. And the LTInsight or the Hadoop-based big data technologies are built within that. Okay. So a little bit about LTInsight, the thing that I just spoke about, as an excited big data platform provided by Microsoft Azure and backed by Azure Virtual Machines and block storage as the storage container. So LTFS files system sits on top of the block storage. I think somebody had a question about how does this LTFS file system works. So it works on top of the block storage. So now I'll talk about that, okay, under which scenarios you should be able to apply LTInsight. LTInsight is an example here. It can be any other big data platform altogether, right? Any provider. So I'll just talk about four different scenarios altogether over here. First one is the iterated exploration. So just think of an example that you are a company and people are tweeting about you, right? Twitter is an unstructured form of data. You don't know that what kind of message are coming, right? So you ingest your data in your LTInsight platform. So LTInsight is just a reference here. It can be replaced by any other data platform. Just to be, that's a disclaimer. Okay, so you are inputting it here. You are doing some sort of evaluation. Then you are seeing that, okay, what kind of information is coming out of it, right? And then you are getting the information back and providing that input to your batch processing altogether until you either find some sort of solution or you don't find any solution altogether or you don't find any other insight information. So that is an iterative exploration under which you can apply a big data technology. Data warehousing on demand. So typically data warehousing is relational databases altogether. You can replace that relational thing with your big data solution and LTInsight in this case. What you do is that you ingest your data and you define a table schema using the edge catalog. So it's a high-bit platform, and edge catalog can be applied to define the schema of your unstructured data altogether, right? And then you can make some meaningful information out of it and use it for your data warehousing purpose for your organization. Yeah, I got it. So third use case is your ETL automation. Most of the organization are still powered by the structured database or the relational database altogether. You can use your LTInsight or your big data platform to do the processing on your input. That input could be the data which is outside your organization, the Twitter example I said, or say the customer feedback altogether, right? And then you can churn the data to store them in any of your structured data format or the relational data format. It could be the SQL Server, it could be SQL Azure, or any other relational database provider. And combine with your internal data to get some meaningful information, right? Say you are selling a product, that is your internal data. People are tweeting about it, people are giving feedback, customers are giving feedback. You combine them to get the insight from the data. So that is another use case. The fourth one is the BI integration. most of the companies, most of the organization or the corporate have the BI tools altogether. They have their own offering, right? So how can the big data solution fit into their existing BI solution, right? So first one, I would say the report level integration, where you have the reporting thing altogether, and you, whatever the information which is coming from your big data solution, you ingest into your reporting system, similarly into the your corporate data model, and the one that we talked about, the ETL stuff, right? So a couple of things that I have talked about, okay, when to choose this model. So, I mean, you will anyways get the slide, so you can just take a look at that, okay, this is the scenario, which model should I use, whether I use the big data solution or not. I think this is the use case that I wanted to cover, and you had some two case studies probably.
Yeah, so I would like open system for QA, okay. And I will meanwhile present those two slides. So these were the use case studies for Microsoft architectures giving architecture. That those are this one, but like two-way session, so you can ask the question. The next slide will be good.
Welcome back. Are we
time?
Simple
security
slide, which is not
covered.
Security.
Yeah, so there was one security slide, right?
Yes. So you have all these slides with you. So Anand will be sharing this slide.
There is nothing to cover in terms of security.
Can you just quickly say in a word what you wanted to say on the
slide? I have time to from you.
You don't promise to me.
Maybe 2 minutes. 2 minutes. Security 2 minutes.
Okay, security 2 minutes.
So I don't tell you what you want to escape, but I don't have the
second title, please. Because that is something
you have to do. Yeah, I can something. Thank you, Anand, for that. Okay. One more problem. Going back. Okay. So let's say you have 4,000 rules. I am just taking an example of this architecture. You have 4,000 rules for it. What is important for any issue? It should be authenticated. And then you can, whenever something is wrong, running, it should be also monitored what this is doing. So that I should not be a case for any person's attack. So that's why they are saying authenticate node using protocol like Kerberos. Or you might use X.05 certification as well. Okay, but this is like pretty common, used in the standard, you can apply this one. Enable file layer encryption. So what happens like when you are putting your data there, trying to use the REST data on REST encryption. Data on REST encryption. When you try to use the analysis, so let the analysis run. So I want to run my new job that might take hours or 2 days for that. Inside when it will come, I will look into that. So you can encrypt the data, and the data is important for this, very much future for my organization. So I don't want to do any kind of with the data. Subscribe to the key management service for trusted keys and certificates. If you talk about Amazon, so they provide you different kind of keys. So many people build this kind of function using keys. The keys here I am talking about is not like a username password. These are some different keys. They say like access key and secret key. The access key and secret key combined together. First, they need your credential, and after that, you will be working with those keys. You can utilize this. Or you can utilize your encryption mechanism for copying private kind of this encryption. You can utilize tools SAM and Puppet because these tools are like vital level that can monitor your system there. On top of that, you can build your security so that you will be knowing what is happening to your machine. And same thing is like whenever you are doing an HTTP call to your machine or any of the Excel call, you need to like encrypt those calls utilizing underlying encrypting techniques like your TLS or SSL. So this is like little insight, but if you want to go in deep, then you can find many things there. Okay. So
it's time for question and answer.
So I will ask for Anand, any more minute?
If you have questions.
I have
a question.
Yes. In the data engine, how does load balancing
What's the question?
So here is like...
So here's the question that in data ingestion, how the load balancing will work?
Load balancing, that's a good question. Yeah.
One question, any other question?
Regarding migration, is there any tools from mainframe to Hadoop, any direct tools or
That is the case study, I will just
I think any of the ETL tools might work there.
ETL tools sometimes like what happens like I told you like this is like multi source pattern, right? In the multi source pattern you might have an ETL source from where you want to put the data. And what generally you do, like you get the data, put into the scoop and it's still better utilized data.
Like
this
like
kind of
thing,
mainframe
code you need to use some
Java
code like that.
Mainframe also can expose some services utilize this, or you can utilize batch layer to see this layer, I can show you that file. That's not meant for only like data ingestion there, but there is like meant for how you can utilize the pattern there. So here is a stage transformation pattern, compression pattern. So I am taking the data from mainframe. How you are taking the data from the mainframe? Either you can directly go to using some batch jobs, okay? Or you can utilize the services as conversion from there. There are many other cloud providers, like talk about Amazon or this thing. They are providing data pipelines, or the data pipeline to utilize to get such deep data. So we already discussed about like the types of the data, right? The variety of the data. So this is like what we're talking about, the variety of the data. It could be image, it could be JPG, it could be video, anything could be there. So you can define the classification of your data. The classification is done before coming to the system. You need to apply some machine learning algorithm. So the image is nothing the blobs, right? You have to buy the array. So if you can read those binary array and do your whatever you want to do, like this is the kind of thing I'm looking for, the pixel or frame size like this. You can put there.
So I know a couple of tools which are available in the Azure Marketplace. You can search. I haven't used it though, but I know a couple of tools available which can do some sort of face matching kind of thing. Okay. So those kind of, it is provided as a service already.
Microsoft has started the API.
Yes, yes, exactly.
So it's part of the Cortana implementation.
Right. Even IBM and the Watson cognitive analysis is also there.
Google has them.
So these are the learnings which I learned from the Bing.
So this is, tell me, this is money oriented or something free from Microsoft?
No, see, there are some limits actually, not for anything.
Satya told, right, like it is a free for
even, so thing is that couple of queries per day will be free, beyond that it will be charged. Similarly for Watson, the queries are charged as so one of their bot platform, the conversational platform, right? First 500 queries are free, but after that it is as much as 50 cents per query, which is a lot, right?
Yes. 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 Lot of patterns, right? Can you map with the technology or the tool that can be leveraged?
I think in the first slide, I already mentioned that one. In the first slide, let me say how this time project will go back. Here you see. These are the technology and stacks what we are talking about, and these are the patterns that will be applicable at it. So I think this is too much dull kind of thing, right? So I will really keep that one so that you can ask it.
So how much do you think providing core mastering job in Java or MIS is good enough for most of the conventional patterns and stuff? Or
no, it's not always needed as you already put there, Hive is there. So I am writing a book on Phoenix also. Phoenix is also one of the things like that. People write SQL query like you write the traditional RDB.
So what I believe is that whatever can be done to map Riddle's job can come to my Hive
is exactly. Right. Yes. So Hive internally if you see they are running the map of Riddle's job.
Yes.
So it's not like managing to be Java for work. Think about something in the traditional architecture, what we do. Like we have something, I have one block pattern, right? if the log pattern doesn't fit what we do. We create our own custom rule. The same thing will be here. If some new thing comes, some new data source comes, so it might be like there is some plugin available for me and using it, otherwise you'll be writing your own custom rule here.
There is no new data. I am creating the data and the data which I have in terms of
maps.
So,
okay.
I mean, do you think
such
changes coming into
the data? Yes, there are changes. Changes will be coming in. Talk about the IoT devices here. We are like very, very hard to use data there.
There are many other like open source Apache, Netflix is also there, you can utilize. These are like mostly of the technology meant for indexing the data in position. And there are many other like available technology other than Hadoop, they built in. EMC Square, and they have their own system like that. Okay, IBM has their own, and they started their writing their own things. It's not like mandatory we should use all these technologies. So you can develop your architecture depending what kind of domain problem you are solving and use case for. It is just like the open source technology I brought is here, you might utilize for the